Okay, these are tough readings for the priests and for the bishops. So you have to pray for us today. We don't like to listen to that warning from the prophet Ezekiel that was our first reading. So we prefer, all of us who are in the position of preaching or of spiritual direction or of leading the Christian community in one way or another, all of us prefer to talk about love. And St. Paul tells us in today's reading that we owe nothing to anyone. He says, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. Okay, we can go with that. I love you. Good. Okay, so that makes you very happy. And we can all go home with smiles on our faces. But what does it mean for me to say that I love you as a priest? That's the problem. Our Lord loves us so much that he has given his life for us. God so loved the world that he gave his only son. And his son loved us so much that he taught us the truth. And because he taught us the truth, what happened? Our Lord himself, the Son of God, was rejected, arrested, tortured, and put to death because he loved us. It is easy, it is so tempting for all of us, myself included, to gloss over what the gospel says and just say, God loves you, whatever that means, and just feel good and go home. And that's not why you came here. You came here today to Mass because you want to come into the presence of and have a relationship with the Son of God, who is the way and the truth and the life. And he has told us that we must proclaim the truth. Remember a couple of Sundays ago, we listened to the 16th chapter of St. Matthew's Gospel. We're now in the 18th chapter, but a couple of Sundays ago, we heard our Lord say to St. Peter, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. And I will give you, he says, the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. He gives his authority to St. Peter and to his church. And he commands St. Peter and he commands the church to proclaim the truth. And we have to do it, as Pope Benedict is fond of reminding us, we have to do it in season and out of season. He's quoting St. Paul when he says that, whether it's fashionable or unfashionable. And the gospel is fashionable in some ways, but in most ways it's not fashionable. It's not even fashionable in the hope that it gives. It's very curious, and I'm sure you've thought about this yourselves and been astonished by this yourselves. It's very curious how few people really are interested in everlasting life. People want to have things as they are right now, and they want to dress them up a little bit. We want to have worldly success. We want things that we know now to go really well for us, and that's all we want. So many people live that way. So few people that I've run into are really, really interested in eternal life. That's the effect of our culture. Our culture seems to dampen down our deepest longings, our deepest hopes, and that's why our culture is so messed up. And that's why bishops, priests, and all of us are called to proclaim the fullness of the truth. So here we go. Here's Ezekiel. He's speaking to me. He's speaking to Archbishop Dolan. He's speaking to Pope Benedict. He's speaking to every priest and bishop and deacon and every teacher and lay leader and every single one of us. Every single one of us. And he says, you, Son of Man, I have appointed watchmen for the house of Israel. When you hear me say anything, you shall warn them for me. That's the problem. Our Lord tells us to say things, and we don't want to say them because they are unpopular. He warns us in Psalm 95 that we prayed together a few moments ago. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. Listen to his voice. And then he tells us very specifically, and he tells us, all of us in the church, especially the leaders of God's people, but all of us in different situations in our lives, he tells us, if I tell the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die. What does that mean? obviously someone who is committing a sin. And if someone commits a grave sin, that person loses his life. The worst tragedy that could ever befall a human being is to commit a mortal sin, because that means we have rejected God. That means that we have chosen to cut off God's life in us. That means we have chosen to say no to everlasting life. It is the worst possible tragedy that could ever occur to anyone. Nothing else is as bad as that. With anything else, there is hope. The worst possible disease that one has, the worst possible situation that one is in, there is hope. But if one has chosen to commit mortal sin and is unrepentant, there is no hope. And my great fear is that there's an awful lot of that going on. And that's why our Lord died for us, precisely for that, because he loves us so much that he doesn't want us to be lost. And so he says to me, to bishops, to priests, and to each one of us, if I tell the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak out to dissuade the wicked from his way, the wicked shall die for his guilt, but I will hold you responsible for his death. This is what love means. This is what love means. If I care about someone, I care ultimately about that person's welfare. If I care about someone, I care about that person's life. If I care about someone, I care most above all about that person's everlasting life. And if I really care about someone, I will take the risk of having that person reject me as we rejected our Lord. I will take the risk of having that person reject me. I will take the risk of being unpopular, whether as a priest or as a layperson in our daily lives. I will take the risk of being unpopular for the sake of speaking the truth that alone can save. That is love. I do not love you if you come to me in confession and say, I am whatever, I'm committing mass murder every day, and I say to you, well, that's fine, just remember God loves you and say a Hail Mary and go away. I have to tell you it's wrong. I have to tell you if you don't stop it, you're gonna lose your everlasting life. And so on with other sins. And I don't want to get into a whole catalog of sins, but there's so many mortal sins, as you and I well know, that are glorified in our culture. Just walk out the door of this church, turn on the TV, pick up the newspaper, you'll see. There are plenty of sins, mortal sins, that are glorified by our culture. It is the heavy responsibility of the church, beginning with the Holy Father and the bishops, but including us priests, including every one of us, to stand up for the truth. And why is that? Because we want to fight people? No, because we love people. Because we want everyone to be saved, we want everyone to be happy. And people are not going to be saved and they're not going to be happy if they choose to commit mortal sin. Our Lord says, pleads over and over again, if today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. And that's the work of the church, to plead with people in the name of the Lord, not to harden their hearts, but let the Lord speak to them and call them to conversion and call them to receive the gift of his forgiveness and the gift of his life and the gift of his joy. That is love. And so today, my brothers and sisters, the Lord is calling us, first of all, to allow him to love us. He loves us with an everlasting love. He loves us with an infinite love. And he doesn't want anything to stand between us and that love. And he freely forgives our sins if we allow him to do so. So let's go to him, burdened as we are with our sins, and allow him to forgive us. But then let us listen. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. Let us listen. And when he sends us in charity, in love, with Christian prudence, if he sends us to someone to say, look, you've got to change, let's do that. Because the Lord calls us to do that, and he gives us the gift of his Holy Spirit to enable us to do that. That is the work of love. we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one in being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray with confidence to our Heavenly Father.
We pray that the Church will continue to bring reconciliation and unity to the world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the right to religious freedom may be respected by the governments of all peoples. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our fellow countrymen, especially those suffering the effects of Hurricane Irene, that a deeper renewal of civic life will follow the unified effort we make to assist the victims in their plight. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we might have greater respect for law and order and the compassion to give fraternal correction to those who do wrong. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the blessings on all children, parents, and teachers at the start of a new school year, that education will contribute to a deeper experience of our humanity and our obligations to one another. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That as we celebrate Labor Day, the Lord will prosper the work of those who labor and show special compassion to those who are unemployed. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and the shut in, especially those who we remember in our parish bulletin, for those suffering the effects of Hurricane Irene, and for our recently deceased, especially Faith McFadden, and the members of our parish purgatorial society, newly enrolled, Nora McKenna. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Loving Father, our life is possible only because of the forgiveness you have shown us. Let us live your mercy each moment of our lives. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Please take a copy of the bulletin for important information and articles. Tomorrow, of course, is national holiday, and masses tomorrow will be at 8 a.m. and 12 noon, and tomorrow the rectory office will be closed. There will be a change in the weekday mass schedule beginning on Tuesday. So tomorrow we'll have a regular weekday mass schedule. There will be a change in the weekday mass schedule beginning on Tuesday, and that's in the bulletin. Our parish religious education program registration will be held next Sunday, September 11th, from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. First day of classes begins on Sunday, September 18th at 10 a.m. They're also sponsoring an apple picking trip on Saturday, September 24th. Our parish 125th anniversary reunion dinner dance for parishioners and school graduates is Saturday, September 17th. And of course, a reminder about our parish trip to Italy in November. Our second collection this weekend is our regular monthly collection to support the maintenance of our church and rectory, and we thank you for your generosity and wish everybody what's left of an enjoyable Labor Day weekend.
Our offertory hymn is number 731. Draw us in the Spirit's tether, 731.
Thank you.
pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his church.
God of peace and love, may our offering bring you true worship and make us one with you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks. We see your infinite power in your loving plan of salvation. You came to our rescue by your power as God, but you wanted us to be saved by one like us. Man refused your friendship, but man himself was to restore it through Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him the angels of heaven offer their prayer of adoration as they rejoice in your presence forever. May our voices be one with theirs in their triumphant hymn of praise. Father, you are holy indeed, and all creation rightly gives you praise. All life, all holiness comes from you, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, by the working of the Holy Spirit. From age to age, you gather a people to yourself, so that from east to west, a perfect offering may be made to the glory of your name. And therefore, Father, we bring you these gifts. We ask you to make them holy by the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate this Eucharist. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks and praise. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." When supper was ended, he took the cup. Again he gave you thanks and praise, gave the cup to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Father, call into mind the death your Son endured for our salvation, his glorious resurrection and ascension into heaven, and ready to greet him when he comes again, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look with favor on your church's offering and see the victim whose death has reconciled us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by his body and blood may be filled with his Holy Spirit and become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make us an everlasting gift to you and enable us to share in the inheritance of your saints with Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, with the apostles, the martyrs, and all your saints, on whose constant intercession we rely for help. Lord, may this sacrifice, which has made our peace with you, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Strengthen in faith and love your pilgrim church on earth, your servant Pope Benedict XVI, our Bishop Timothy, and all the bishops, with the clergy and the entire people your Son has gained for you. Father, hear the prayers of the family you have gathered here before you. In mercy and love, unite to yourself all your children, wherever they may be. Welcome into your kingdom our departed brothers and sisters, and all who have left this world in your friendship. There we hope to enjoy with them forever the vision of your glory through Christ our Lord, from whom all good things come. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Taught by our Savior's command and formed by the Word of God, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin, and protect us from all anxiety, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours, now and forever.
Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are they who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Like a deer that longs for running streams, my soul longs for you, my God. My soul is thirsting for the living God.
Let us pray. Lord, by your word and your sacrament, you give us food and life. May this gift of your Son lead us to share his life forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Our recessional hymn is number 541. O God, beyond all praising. 541.
Jenny.
Our opening hymn is number 669, All People That on Earth Do Dwell, 669.
Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Lord, you are just and the judgments you make are right. Show mercy when you judge me, your servant. My brothers and sisters in Christ, to prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries, let us acknowledge our sin. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned through my own fault in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. And I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Hail, 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 Hail
Glory to God in the highest. And make us your children in Christ. Look upon us, give us true freedom, and bring us to the inheritance you promised. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Readings begin on number 931 in the Red Worship Book. A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord, "You, son of man, I have appointed watchmen for the house of Israel. When you hear me say anything, you shall warn them for me. If I tell the wicked, 'O wicked one, you shall surely die,' and you do not speak out to dissuade the wicked from his way, the wicked shall die for his guilt, but I will hold you responsible for his death. But if you warn the wicked, trying to turn him from his way, and he refuses to turn from his way, he shall die for his guilt, but you shall save yourself." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us kneel before the God who made us.
today you would listen to his voice. Harden not your hearts as at Meribah, as on that day at Massah in the desert, when your fathers put me to the test. When they tried me,
reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not kill, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other commandment there may be, are summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no evil to the neighbor. Hence, love is the fulfillment of the law. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have won over your brother. If he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, so that every fact may be established on the testimony of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell the church. If he refuses to listen even to the church, then treat him as you would a Gentile or a tax collector. Amen, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Amen, amen, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything for which they are to pray, it shall be granted to them by my heavenly Father. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Okay, this is not the easiest set of readings to preach on, and because it points a finger at me, and it points a finger at everyone else who's trying to preach on them today. And it says, to anyone in a position of responsibility in the church, certainly if that person is a bishop or a priest, anyone who preaches, anyone who teaches, anyone in a leadership position, and finally, every one of us, it says to every one of us, "I have appointed you a watchman for the house of Israel. When you hear me say anything, you shall warn them for me. And he goes on to say that we must reprove the one he calls the wicked one. If I tell the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die. And you do not speak out to dissuade the wicked from his way. The wicked shall die for his guilt, but I will hold you responsible for his death. Very tough reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. It's so much easier for me as a priest. It's so much easier, ask any bishop. It's so much easier for every one of us in our daily lives to talk about love, because you know what we do with the word love in our culture. Love in our culture means next to nothing. But it basically means feel good and smile. I mean, it's come down to that with so many people. So, St. Paul says in today's reading, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. Okay, we can do that. I love you. God loves you. Have a good day. And that's it. And I haven't done my job if I simply say that. I hope you know that God loves you. And certainly my responsibility is to remind you how much God loves you. And let's think for a moment what that love means. St. John tells us, God so loved the world that he gave his son. Now we're beginning to understand what love is. Love means total giving. God gives his total self, his son, to us. And his son gives himself to us. And what is the gift that he gives to us? He proclaims the truth, because he himself is the way, the truth, and the life. We read the Gospels and we see our Lord teaching, and people are amazed at his words. He proclaims the truth. He tells us the truth about how much God loves us. He tells us the truth then about how we are to return that love so that we can have God's life within us. And there were those who did not want to hear that truth because it meant that they had to change their lives. So they did to our Lord what they did to St. John the Baptist before him. They arrested him, they tortured him, and they murdered him because they didn't want to hear the truth. But what is the truth? The truth is God's love. God loves us so much that he has given us his son, who because of our sins, because we have rejected him, has died for us and risen again to give us life. God has given us everything. That is what love means. Love means that God wants every one of us to live in a deep personal relationship with him. Love means that God wants every one of us to have the fullness of his presence. Love means that God wants every one of us to have the fullness of his love and his life. Love means that God wants us to have everlasting life, because St. John reminds us God is love. And God loves us so much that he also gives us the gift of freedom, the gift of deciding for ourselves if we're going to return his love or not. So we can choose. We can choose to receive this awesome love beyond our imagining. We can choose to receive the gift of God's presence, the gift of God's love, the gift of God's life, the fullness of life. We can choose to receive the gift of everlasting life. Or we can choose to say no. But if we say no to love, if we say no to life, then we are choosing death. And if you love someone, if I love someone, we don't want that person to die. And so we do everything we can to keep that person from dying. We'll take a person to all sorts of medical doctors and have them go through all sorts of treatments to prevent them from dying. But what about eternal death? What will we do to save them from eternal death? What will we do for someone we love to help them to have eternal life? If we love them, we will do everything we can to help them have eternal life. And just as we would say to someone, you have stage 4 cancer, you have to go to a doctor, so we must say to someone, you are living in sin, whatever that sin might be. You need to go to confession, or you're going to lose your soul. And we're afraid very often. And this starts with bishops, and includes priests, it includes lay people in positions of authority, it includes every one of us in our own lives. We are afraid because we know Every one of us here knows, if I go to my friend, whoever, who is living in a situation of sin, my friend who is doing something very, very bad, my friend who obviously is committing mortal sin, if I say to that person, in all charity, look, I love you, you've got to change. I am afraid. I'm afraid that my friend will get angry with me. I'm afraid that my friend will reject me. And think about bishops and priests. We are afraid. We are afraid. We are afraid that if we say, you can't commit this kind of a sin, and that sin happens to be something very popular in our culture, we're afraid that people will not like us. We're afraid that the collection will go down. I remember to this day, several years ago, it was a daily mass in another parish, and the gospel for that day was our Lord saying, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery. He says it. So I was basically repeating the words of the gospel and then going on to explain what that means in ordinary life for so many people, trying to do it in a non-inflammatory way, as you can imagine. And there was this poor young woman, probably in her 30s, sitting in the back of the church, who was visibly upset the longer I spoke, and who turned red and got up and stormed out. And I don't know what her situation was, but I could only imagine. And if I wanted her to like me, I wouldn't have said what I said. But we have to proclaim the truth. Otherwise, people will die. Otherwise, people will lose their souls. If the Catholic Church in this culture does not proclaim the truth of how we are to live our lives, if the Catholic Church in our culture does not proclaim the truth of what we need to do to achieve salvation, then who will? Then who will? Everyone else, not everyone else, but so many want to pander, whether they're politicians or people in the media, and they pander to the lowest common denominator, and they encourage people in their sins. And so we have a culture of death, as Blessed John Paul the Great pointed out to us, where people embrace things that lead to eternal death, and even things that lead to physical death, a culture of death. And we are called to proclaim the truth, to call people from death to life. And so the Lord says to you and to me, you son of man, I have appointed watchmen for the house of Israel. When you hear me say anything, you shall warn them for me. That is our responsibility. We need to pray for one another that we can do that. And it's a difficult job for priests, I can tell you. It's a difficult job for bishops, because you have to say it the right way in our culture. And any bishop can tell you, especially here in New York and other metropolitan areas, no matter what he says, his words will instantly be twisted. And if he says anything that goes against the culture, everyone in the media will try to portray him as being this stern, mean old man. And that's a risk that bishops have to take. It's a risk that the priests have to take. It's a risk that we all have to take. St. Matthew's Church, St. Matthew, of course, is writing his gospel for the early church, speaks about how we are to help one another when someone falls into sin. So he presents a situation where someone is in a very serious sin. And you start on the lowest possible level. This is how church government works. You start on the lowest possible level. And he was saying, look, tell the person you're doing this very bad thing. Really, the Lord wants you to stop. And then they up the ante. And canon law is kind of modeled on this. If that doesn't work, then you get a couple of church. And finally, if the person rejects the church, then that person is excommunicated, is basically what this is about. And he's speaking about the authority of the church, because the church has the responsibility and the authority to proclaim the truth. And sometimes the church has to take action against someone in love for the sake of that person's soul, and also for the sake of people who are scandalized by that person's behavior. I don't want to get too specific, because you could think about people in public life and private life and all of the rest. It's difficult, but it's the work of love. And so today, we come before the God of love, the God who loves us so much that he has given us his Son. And we ask him, first of all, to help us see our own sins that need correction, that need repentance and forgiveness. And then to help us in charity, wherever God sends us, to whomever God sends us, to be witnesses to the truth, because the truth alone is what love is all about.